After 804 days, Kylie is coming home.
I am extremely pleased that Dr. Kylie Moore-Gilbert has been released. She is healthy and she is in good spirits.
I've always believed in miracles and I'm just thankful for this one as well.
The Middle East expert from Melbourne University was arrested after attending a conference outside of Tehran in September 2018.
At that point, she was caught up in the machinery of the Iranian state, and it's very difficult to get her out.
In a secret trial, Kylie was sentenced to 10 years jail for espionage.
A conviction that Australia has always rejected.
She was then forced to endure horrendous conditions in both Evin and Karchak prisons, all the while protesting her innocence.
It's where they conduct most of their executions. It's where they torture people and interrogate them.
Veteran war correspondent Michael Ware has been covering conflict in the Middle East for two decades and says Kylie's well-being was always on his mind.
It is an absolute nightmare that she has escaped from. She'll never be the same again.
Her release has been an absolute priority for the government.
Kylie's release was reportedly secured as part of a prisoner swap, with three Iranian nationals released from detention in Thailand. Two of those men appear to have been convicted of terror-related charges. Today, the government was tight-lipped on the topic.
The Australian government doesn't acknowledge or confirm any such arrangements.
I'm not going to comment on diplomatic discussions with other governments.
The first rule of prisoner swap is you don't mention prisoner swap. Is it right to let these men go who were accused of trying to blow up Bangkok and were caught with bombs in their house? Yes, it's right to swap them. You have to understand, this is the way the game's played.
Kylie released a statement praising the tireless work of the Australian Foreign Ministry, adding, "Thank you also to all of you who have campaigned for my freedom. It has meant the world to me. I have nothing but respect, love and admiration for the great nation of Iran. It is with bittersweet feelings that I depart your country, despite the injustices which I have been subjected to."
Kylie, you're amazing.
This is cause for great relief.
Now she finally has her destiny back in her own hands.
Peter Grester is a journalist who knows all too well what it's like to be wrongfully detained in an overseas prison. He spent 13 months in an Egyptian jail on spurious charges, and he's been good enough to join us now with his reflections. Peter, how did you feel when you heard the news of Kylie's release?
Well, I haven't stopped grinning. It's been fantastic news. It comes as such a massive relief. I know, as you said, what it's like to be stuck inside a prison on spurious charges. I know what it's like to experience the frustration of seeing no light at the end of the tunnel, and I know what it's like to be released without warning like this. So, you know, I feel so elated for her, I really do.
What do you think would be going through Kylie's mind at the moment, Peter?
I remember when I was released, I had no warning whatsoever, and if what we've heard about Kylie's release is true, it seems likely that she didn't have any warning either. And for me, I often think about it as being a bit like Christmas. You know, when you're a kid, Christmas is coming, you plan for it, you dream about it, you wait for it, and then the morning of Christmas you wake up and you dive into those presents and you have a fantastic time. But imagine if you kind of wake up and all you end up with one random morning, is a pile of gifts. You're kind of not sure whether they're for you, you don't know whether it's okay to open them, and if you do, whether you're going to get in trouble, whether it's some kind of really bad joke. And it takes a while before you actually get into the idea that these are genuine, that this is a real thing. And that was how it was for me. I was physically free. I knew that I was free, but I really didn't feel it in my heart until I stepped back off the plane. And I suspect for Kylie, that's what she's going through as well.
So, Peter, having gone through it, how hard is this these next few weeks, these next few months, year going to be?
Look, I think it's going to be very difficult. It was for me, and I can only really speak from my own experience, but one of the things that I found really difficult was recognising that I was never going back to the life that I had before. It took a long time and a lot of grieving, to be honest with you, before I realised that I couldn't go back to normal. It was what I wanted more than anything else, just to get back to the life that I had before. But I also came to recognise that there is no way that you can go through something like this and simply pick up where you left off as if nothing had happened. You have to embrace the idea that this is now a part of who you are, and you need to build on that and move forward. But it is not an easy transition to make.
Peter, this is a really tiny club. Are you planning on reaching out to Kylie at all, or would you be prepared to reach out and chat to her?
Yeah, no, I'd love to. I think it's really important. And I've met a couple of other people, other former prisoners who've been through a similar situation, and there is something really powerful, really important about speaking with others who've been through that experience.
According to her statements, she still holds a lot of affection for Iran, and I'm trying to work out what we should make of that. Is that something that she actually feels, or it's the sort of thing she might have been told to say?
No, I think that's a really healthy thing, and I genuinely believe that that's how she feels. I certainly felt that way towards Egypt and Egyptians. I had no animosity at all towards the people generally. And remember, Kylie is a scholar of Iranian culture, Iranian politics. She chose that route because she loves the country, she loves the people, she loves the culture. And I don't think any of that would have changed. The healthy thing to do is to acknowledge that what she went through, as I did, was the fault or the responsibility of a small group of individuals, not of the entire nation, of the entire country. And making that distinction between them, I think, is a really positive step forward. So, no, I think she genuinely feels it, and I commend her for it.
Well, Peter, you have unparalleled insight into what, for everyone else, I think, is a very opaque situation. So it's been great to get your perspectives tonight. Thank you so much.
No, it's been a great pleasure. Thanks, Willie.